Your Excellencies, Members of Parliament, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. Allow me first of all to thank the organizers for inviting me. It is an honor and responsibility to speak to such a high-level audience in a temple of international law such as the Peace Palace. International law has changed significantly during the last century, and so have the fields it regulates. Topics dealt with by international law have increased substantially, reducing the notion of domestic jurisdiction, which is mentioned in Article 2.7 of the United Nations Charter of San Francisco. It has changed also with respect to sources, customary law being no longer the main cornerstone of the international legal framework, having expanded to other fields, such as those related to individuals. In order to understand the crucial role played by international law in promoting human rights, let me briefly recall the essential steps which led to such a significant achievement. I'm going quickly because it's a little bit long. In classic international community, subjectivity used to be a requirement entirely dedicated to states, at least until the Second World War. The category of subjectivity started to be extended to international organizations, as clearly stated in the Bernadotte Advisory Opinion, which was released by the International Court of Justice in 1949. After the Second World War, new subjects were accessing the international community. The first and mainly quoted examples are, of course, the United Nations system and later the European Community, now European Union. They were not only among the first in absolute terms, but also those which first pioneered an expansion of international law into the field of human rights. Such expansion occurred while jurists and especially newly born international courts started to inquire the possibility to further extend the subjects of the international community. Those courts paved the way to the enlargement of juridical subjectivity to entities which were not deemed so in classic international community. Just to quote the most recurrent example, besides the ICJ Bernadotte Advisory Opinion, this is actually what happened through the jurisprudence of the European Court of Justice. Although in the 1957 Rome treaties the European Community had no competence at all on human rights, the European Court of Justice played a pivotal role in assessing that the European Community had competence on human rights even before the treaties, especially the 1992 Maastricht Treaty and the 2007 Lisbon Treaty, officially defined the EU's competence on this sector. Many sentences were delivered on the topic during the 60s and the 70s, stating that the competence on human rights might be identified if triggered by a violation of articles of the treaties. This first step led to a slow but eventually general acknowledgement that the safeguard of human rights had to become a cornerstone of European Union law. Although full subjectivity of individuals is still debated by jurists, there is substantial and unanimous evidence that in modern international community, individuals may be, in some cases, direct subjects to certain norms of international law and, therefore, directly participate to the legal framework. This understanding does not prejudge the common rule that, generally speaking, international law affects individuals only through the process of adaptation, which governments enact in order to introduce international norms into their domestic legal systems. Without affecting such a general rule, we may say that there are norms which are directly dedicated to individuals and which do not immediately require an adaptation in order to be legally binding. In the long history of the upsurge of human rights in current international law, it is widely known that the most important factor was the increasing sensitivity of public opinions for respect and promotion of human rights after the Second World War. Until then, the most remarkable branch of international law dedicated to individuals, besides the law on foreigners, was merely the respect of humanitarian law, which safeguards individuals during wartime and regards the respect of jus in bello. As you well know, humanitarian law has been a major part of international law since the second half of the 19th century through the first Geneva Conventions. Human rights started to acquire an autonomous standing in international law after the foundation of the United Nations in 1945 and the Council of Europe in 1949. They both stimulated a very intense debate on providing legal standing for safeguarding human rights through the 1948 Universal Declaration of Human Rights, although not legally binding, and the Convention for the Protection of Human Rights and Fundamental Freedoms signed in 1950 within the Council of Europe. International organizations started putting individuals at the core of their activities, while international law reaffirmed the intangibility of human rights. The major achievements from this point of view are the aforementioned European Convention on Human Rights and the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union, which was adopted in 2000 and lately in the acquis communautaire through the Lisbon Treaty. However, the respect of human rights and its major role in current international law would not be equally meaningful without the sanctioning moment of international courts, which nowadays have become a cornerstone of the international judicial system. States have set up international courts whose core mandate is the enforcement and sanctioning of violation of human rights. The first examples have been the ad hoc tribunals, such as the ICTY and the ICTR, while a more recent example is the Special Tribunal for Lebanon. The need for a permanent and structured court of this type led to the foundation of the ICC through the 1998 Statute of Rome. Italy, as you know, is proactive in promoting the respect and safeguard of human rights, not only through raising awareness across international public opinion, but also through a wide and deeper role of international law in enhancing the legal framework of human rights, especially at the UN level. This obviously without forgetting the role of universal conventions. But soft law acts, such as those adopted by international organizations, are as equally important as legally binding treaties or conventions, because they aim at bolstering consensus on the importance of promoting human rights. A further example are the declarations adopted by the OSCE ministerial conferences. This is what has occurred with death penalty, which Italy has fiercely and very actively opposed for decades. Although there's no universal legally binding convention banning death penalty, that is regulated by domestic legislation. Italy has promoted a number of resolutions of of the United Nations General Assembly. Let us recall those adopted in 2007, 8, 10, 12, and 14, calling for a moratorium on death penalty. The only legally binding treaty instrument at a regional level is the Protocol 13 of the Convention for the Protection of Human Rights and Fundamental Freedoms, as well as the European Convention on Human Rights and the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union. Death penalty is not the only issue on which Italy has acted within the safeguard of human rights. Today's world clearly demonstrates that the protection and promotion of freedom of religion or belief is not only essential to peaceful international relations, but also to a peaceful cohabitation of cultures within societies. In this regard, freedom of religion or belief has to be promoted not only by domestic legislation, as it is enshrined in many constitutions, but also through international conventions. Just to mention the main one, the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, adopted in 1966 at UN level, or the Convention for the Protection of Human Rights and Fundamental Freedoms, signed in 1950 at Council of Europe level. Italy has been equally engaged in stressing the importance of gender balance and promotion of women's and children's rights. If international law set the standards with the 1979 UN Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women and the 1989 UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, a further step was marked by the UN Security Council Resolution 1325 of 2000 on women, peace and security, calling for the adoption of a gender perspective to consider special needs of women and girls during conflict, repatriation and resettlement, rehabilitation, reintegration, and post-conflict reconstruction. Italy has actively supported this issue also during the specific debate held last week in the Security Council of the UN. Another major topic is massive migration. In the last two decades, we have witnessed the increasing phenomenon of smuggling of migrants and trafficking of human beings. It is an issue previously addressed at international level by the two Palermo protocols. Our new president is from Palermo, by the way, and we are very happy I'm from Palermo too. So we have a new president of the Republic from yesterday. He's a great man. It is an issue previously addressed at international level by the two Palermo protocols, supplementing the 2000 United Nations Convention Against Transnational Organized Crime. Both protocols have adopted a double approach in defining smuggling and trafficking. They are a transnational threat, therefore being a security issue, but they also, and primarily, are a human rights issue. On this subject, we have experienced the will to increase cooperation on the involved international organizations, such as IOM, Council of Europe, EU, OSCE, UN, at least on legal terms, aiming at tackling the issue on the basis of the joint Palermo Protocol's definitions. But much needs still to be done by the international community and by the European Union. We need to further translate words in actions. However, the protection of human rights may not be regarded as a solely juridical problem related to the instruments, national and international, which have to be triggered in order to implement binding commitments. Human rights are also an issue capable of inspiring and orienting foreign policy. For instance, they are an essential condition for accessing membership in the European Union, as well as in NATO, and its respect is a condition which has to permanently be safeguarded according to EU standards and legal framework. Promotion of human rights and strengthening of international legal framework constitute a major objective of the Italian foreign policy. Yeah, I know, but the previous speaker had also 15 minutes of questions. I will avoid questions, thank you. The promotion of human rights and strengthening of international legal framework constitute a major objective of the Italian foreign policy and a clear inspiration of our priorities and values. This is one of the pillars of Italy's campaign for a non-permanent seat at the United Nations Security Council for the years 2017-2018. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, allow me to go back to the issue of the interplay between the rights of migrants and the social needs of European states that constitutes a new frontier for human rights, as well as a challenge for international law. I will offer you a few concrete examples of such an interplay related only to Italy, obviously only to Italy because I don't want to offend any other country. So it could be interpreted as going against the interests of Italy. That's not to, it wants to give you some practical examples in order to understand better the problems. A leading case in this respect is a judgment from the European Court of Human Rights of 2012 related to events in 2009, when Somali and Eritrean nationals were rescued in the Mediterranean Sea by an Italian military vessel and transported to Libya. Case Hirsi Jama and others versus Italy, judgment of the 23rd of February 2012. The court established an important premise. If the acts of one of the 47 state members of the Council of Europe are performed and produce effects outside that state's territory, the high seas, these acts, however, constitute exercise of jurisdiction by that state over certain individuals, and therefore the state is under an obligation to ensure protection of the rights under the Convention. The corollary of this important premise is that, although European states are under pressure due to the increasing influx of extra EU migrants, which is a particularly complex phenomenon when occurring by sea, this does not allow them not to comply with their obligations, such as that of not expelling persons running the risk of being subjected in the receiving country to treatment prohibited under Article 3, whether the departure country or the country of origin. This means that if migrants are intercepted in the high sea by a state member vessel, the passengers must be rescued and transferred to the state vessel. They cannot simply be taken back to the country from which they departed without an examination of each individual situation. If no identification procedures carried out by the member states' authorities and the migrants and asylum seekers are shipped off to the receiving country at risk, Libya in the examined case, the removal of the migrants amounts, according to the European Court, to an infringement of the prohibition of torture and ill treatment, Article 3, as well as a collective expulsion of aliens in breach of Article 4 of Protocol Number 4 to the European Convention for the Protection of Human Rights and Fundamental Freedoms. Not even the danger of terrorism can affect this judicial construction. In another case, Saadi versus Italy, judgment of 28th of February 2008, the European Court, while stressing the danger of terrorism and the considerable difficulties that states face in protecting their communities from terrorist violence, found that a suspect terrorist foreigner cannot be expelled if he is at risk of ill treatment and torture in his home country. Even where the person in question is considered to represent a serious danger to the community, the court held that it would be incorrect to require a higher standard of evidence about the risk of ill treatment or torture in the country of origin. The concepts of risk and dangerousness in this context do not lend themselves to a balancing test because they are notions that can only be assessed independently of each other. So, even if the mere decision, although not yet enforced, to deport a foreigner suspected of terrorism to a country at risk may amount to a violation of Article 3. As you see, these are all very, current cases and issues. Member states encounter, and I'm closing quite soon, obstacles to the expulsion of foreigners even when less important rights are at stake, such as that enshrined in Article 8, right of respect for private and family life, which is deemed less prominent than the prohibition of torture and ill treatment. In the Hamidovic versus Italy case, judgment of the 4th of December 2012, the applicant was a Bosnian national of Roma origin whose renewal of residence permit was refused on the ground that she had committed criminal offences. As a result, she was deported for illegally remaining in Italy. Relying on Article 8, the applicant complained that her deportation to Bosnia and Herzegovina had resulted in a violation of her right to respect for her private and family life, as she had been forced to leave her husband and children behind in Italy. The finding of the court was a violation by the state of her right enshrined in Article 8. This excursus shows how complex the position of a European state is faced with the possible threats deriving from irregular migration. These movements of persons can at times be justified by the dictatorial regime or by the poor conditions of their countries of origin, but they may also give rise to further insecurity and feelings of anxiety for Europe. How to cope with these different needs, the respect of individual rights of migrants on one hand, and the safeguard of social needs and the duty of the European countries to protect their citizens on the other, is certainly a crucial challenge not to turn down by the scholars of international law in today's historical context. International law and human rights have nowadays unquestionably enormous influence over the social and political life of states, and this influence risks straining the implementation of international judgments by domestic authorities in our difficult historical contingency when the feeling of security is perceived as threatened. Thank you for your patience.